Good morning, church.
Good morning.
Glad to see y'all today. It's a beautiful Sunday morning to come worship the Lord. Of course, I've got a few things to run my trap about first before we get into the service. Don't forget, even though it's not in the bulletin, because we were had some problems with the bulletin this week, we do have the single service next Sunday. Single service Sunday. It's easy to remember that way. Next Sunday at 10 o'clock, I hope that you will be here. We're going to have, you know, the praise team and the choir. All of it's going to be part of the service. We're inviting people, or asking you to invite people that don't normally attend our church to be here and invite them to stay over. We want to also welcome all of you that may be worshiping with us for the first time, and I appreciate y'all being here. And then there's another one. These right here, matter of fact, I think I'm gonna let the lady in charge tell you about them. Come on up, Janet. Yeah, we want to hear from you.
In your bulletin, you see an advertisement for our spaghetti dinner, which is the 21st of September.
I can hear you, baby. You're having a real plus. Thank you.
Eat the mic.
No.
In your bulletin, there is a reminder of the spaghetti dinner, which is September 21st from 5 to 7. Eat in or take out. You need to have a ticket. They are $9 a piece. There'll be spaghetti, salad, a dessert, bread, and a drink for the eat-in. Carryouts won't have a drink. So, I have tickets. There'll be tickets in the office. Lisa Wickham has tickets. Shane Ham has tickets at PostNet. So, make sure you get your ticket. Thank you.
And what they told me, this is something Lisa reminded me, if you get tickets, they're going to sign you out however many tickets you got, and then what? Then they'll need the money back by the 16th or either the tickets returned so they can be prepared for that. And one other thing I need help with today, starting tomorrow, they're putting the carpet in. So we need help at 2:30 today. We're not going to have to move the piano or the big, big, heavy stuff, but we've got a lot of oddball stuff from up front that we've got to get out of the way, and we'd appreciate having help at 2:30 today. And then the last announcement I want to make is the SPRC decided just this week, and it's been arranged, that we have hired a children's coordinator that will be someone that we pay to help oversee this program, but Carolyn Harris and Alyssa Ham are still going to be working with it. We appreciate that. But the new person that we have hired is Juliana Rowland. So someone from our own church that grew up here is going to be helping with that. So y'all, let's really pray for Juliana. This is something new. She's really grown into this over the last couple of years. I'm excited about it. But pray for Juliana, and anytime she makes any call for help, let's respond, because she's going to need all the help she can get. But we're super excited about that. Is there any other announcements that need to be made this morning? Okay, we traditionally start with prayer for worship, right? Because we try to set aside all the announcements, all the other stuff we've been doing, and to move into worship. I want to ask you to be part of this opening worship, our prayer. And here's what I would like to ask of you. I'd like to ask of you if you would have a short prayer in addition to mine, asking what you would want God to do in this service. And what help you need from God so that you can worship Him properly. I would like for us all to express God our appreciation and for us to really talk about what we hope to experience in this worship service in this opening prayer. So if you'll join me in that, I would greatly appreciate it. Heavenly Father, we come before you today, and Lord, my prayer is that your Holy Spirit would fall down on us today And Lord, you would enable us to worship you in spirit and in truth. Lord, that you would enable us to hear you and to experience you. But Father, I want to give my brothers and sisters also to take a moment to say what they hope will happen in this worship service today. Anyone?
Lord, I pray that we, each one of us, feels your touch, Lord, to know that we are not alone, no matter if we are streaming online or if we are sitting here without anyone near us, Lord, that we even know, and we're a visitor. I just pray that you will help everyone feel like they've been touched today by you.
Anyone else? Why did you come here? What did you hope to experience with God?
Lord, I pray that you will open our hearts and our minds to your word. Forgive us for our sin. Bless our country.
Anyone else? Father, you've heard our prayers, and we just ask that you meet us in this place. In Jesus Christ's holy name we pray. Amen.
Join in singing now, For the Beauty of the Earth, hymn number 92. You're welcome to follow along with the words on the wall or use your hymnals.
By popular demand, is also a very precious creed that speaks of the Christian faith. Let's join together. We believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. On the third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sat down at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
You may be seated. Let us sing now together, "'Tis So Sweet to Trust in Jesus," hymn number 462. Time for our children to come forward for their time with Brother D. All right. I'm gonna go see my mother
since somebody else. Okay.
I'm gonna do it today. Miss Sherry, their water is out at their house. And I understand if you ladies don't have the water to get ready and can't get all prettied up, sometimes it's hard to get. Well, hello. It's good to have you. All right, I want to ask y'all a question. Why did y'all choose to come to church today? To learn about Jesus. All right. Learn about Jesus. Well, why did you choose to come here instead of just staying at home this morning? Could have you just stayed at home? Sometimes it's tempting to stay home, isn't it? Did you know that a lot that we do, the choices that we make, really shows God sometimes what we really think and what we really believe. When y'all get older, you're going to have a lot of choices to make. Like, you'll have choices of whether you study hard or goof off. You're going to have choices to come to church or not. You're going to have choices that when you start dating, about who you're going to go see, to go out with. You're going to have choices about where you work. But the biggest choice you have to make is, will I still continue to learn and grow and accept Jesus? Because believe me, the world's going to try to get you to choose different from that. But if you'll stay true to Jesus, things will go way better for you, okay? All right, let's pray. Heavenly Father, I just pray for these precious children here. Father, the choices that they will have to be faced with in their own future, Lord, that you will undergird them, strengthen them. And I pray, Lord, that maybe, just maybe, as they get older, they just might remember an old preacher sitting down with them and remind them these choices do matter. In Jesus' name, amen.
Lord, that we would not forget them, and that we would Father, I also, as usual, make time in this prayer time for us to lift up our own personal concerns. And so please hear the prayer concerns of my brothers and sisters.
Amy Collier.
Clark Griffith. Let it go.
Thank you.
open hearts. Help us, Lord, to be more generous, reflecting your love on others. Bless these offerings to further your kingdom and bless us as cheerful givers. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
This next song that I'm going to sing for you today is a very special song to a lot of us, especially in my family. And in recognition of Grandparents' Day today, I would love to sing this song called When They Ring Those Golden Bells. It's a special song that my grandparents both loved, and I know Bob Walden, he's requested this song too. So the choir and I would like to sing this song for you. Dwell with the immortals when they ring those golden bells for you and me. Don't you hear the bells now ringing? Don't you hear? Shining river, when they ring those golden bells for you and me. When life is over and over, when the death we sleetly slumber, when the King commands the Spirit to be that lovely Aden, when they ring those golden bells for you and me. Don't you hear the bells now ringing? Don't you hear? Today's scripture reading comes from Joshua 1, 1 through 2, 6 through 8. After the death of Moses, the Lord's servant, the Lord spoke to Joshua, son of Nun, Moses' assistant. He said, "Now that my servant Moses is dead, you must lead my people across Jordan River to the land I am giving them. Be strong and of good courage. For to this people you shall divide as an inheritance the land which I swore to their fathers to give to them. Only be strong and very courageous, that you may observe to do according to all the law which Moses, my servant, commanded you. Do not turn from it to the right hand or to the left, that you may prosper wherever you go. This book of the law shall not depart from your mouth, but you shall meditate in it day and night, that you may observe to do according to all that is written in it. For then you will make your way prosperous, and then you will have good success. The years passed, and the Lord had given the people of Israel rest from all their enemies. Joshua, who was now very old, called together all the elders, leaders, judges, and officers of Israel. He said to them, I am an old man now. Soon I will die, going the way of all the earth. Deep in your hearts, you know that every promise of the Lord your God has come true. Not a single one has failed. So honor the Lord and serve him wholeheartedly. Put away forever the idols your ancestors worshipped when they lived beyond the Euphrates River and in Egypt. Serve the Lord alone. But if you are unwilling to serve the Lord, then choose today whom you will serve. Would you prefer the gods your ancestors served beyond the Euphrates? Or would it be the gods of the Amorites in whose land you now live? But as for me and my family, we will serve the Lord. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Jennifer. Well, ladies, I was trying to find a picture of what Joshua might have looked at and picked that one because I thought y'all might enjoy some eye candy this morning while I was preaching. Cold showers will be available after the service. Last week we talked about Moses and all he had done, how he died, and now Joshua was called to lead God's people into the promised land. Joshua had been born into captivity, but as they got to move out, Joshua got chosen to be Moses' assistant. Matter of fact, according to the Bible, though he didn't get to go all the way up Mount Sinai, he was the one that got to accompany Moses up a good way on Mount Sinai when Moses would receive the law. He's the guy that would sit outside the tent of meeting that I told you about last week. When Moses would go in to meet with God, it would be Joshua that would get the privilege of standing outside that tent. He would be the one that would lead the Hebrews into battle when they were facing enemies before Moses died and even after Moses died. He was one of the 12 spies that was chosen by Moses to go and check out the promised land. And when they came back, all 10 of the 12 said, "We can't do this. The army's too big. The people are too big." But Caleb and Joshua said, "No, we trust in the Lord. Let's go." But the people refused. They chose to not trust God. And so they wandered for 40 years until that entire generation passed away. Including, as we read last week, even Moses didn't get to go into the promised land. The only two that got the reward of going into the promised land was Caleb and Joshua. So now it's time, we step forward, and it's now time for Joshua to step up and lead the people. But Joshua would have to choose to trust God and to be obedient to everything that God had. And by doing so, he would get to be the one who would be successful getting to go into the promised land. But it meant trusting God for some very unusual things. For example, it's time for the people to cross the Jordan River, which was, according to the Bible, at flood stage. So that meant they either needed to wait till the flood dissipated and they could try to get across, or maybe build a bridge, or maybe build some boats. But that's not what God said. God was going to test them and find out if they were going to trust him this time. So God said, I will not stop the water until you get the priest with the Ark of the Covenant and step out into the water, and then only will the water stop. And so that's exactly what happened. Then it came time for them to face the people of Jericho. We all remember that story from when we were a kid. Jericho was a well-fortified city with high city walls. And what they normally would have done in those days is build ramparts or bridges or some way that they could go over the top of those walls and get in. But God said, nope, not going to do it that way. He tells Joshua, you take your fighting men and you walk around the city one time for 6 days. But on the seventh day, I want all the people to join, and I want the priest to blow the ram's horn. And when the ram's horn is blown, I want the people to shout, and then you will have victory. And that's exactly what happened. They had to trust God in this unusual way, and they prospered. But now we skip ahead in today's text. Joshua is old. God has allowed him to lead the people into the promised land, and he calls all the people together, and he recounts all that God has done for them, and he says, God has never let you down. He kept every promise. But he knows the people. He says, folks, it's time for you to choose. Are you going to choose the false gods of this world? Or are you going to choose to follow the one true God? And so they say, well, we choose to serve the Lord and the Lord alone. That sounds great, doesn't it? Does it? But did they? You see, as soon as you flip out of the book of Joshua, you get to the book of Judges. And we read this in Judges 2. After Joshua sent the people away, each of the tribes left to take possession of the land allotted to them. And the Israelites served the Lord throughout the lifetime of Joshua and the leaders who outlived him, those who had seen the great things the Lord had done for Israel. Then Joshua, son of Nun, the servant of the Lord, died in the age of 110. Buddy, that's a few years there, y'all. They buried him in the land he had inherited. And then it says in verse 10, though, after that generation died, another generation grew up who did not acknowledge the Lord or remember the mighty things he'd done. Then the people did what was evil in the Lord's sight, and they worshiped the false gods. They chose to forget all that God had done. And so they didn't make the good choices Joshua did. And so even though God would send prophets to warn them to repent, they would choose to ignore those prophets. And so they suffered the consequence of those bad choices. For we know that God allowed the northern kingdom to be attacked by the Assyrians, and the southern kingdom attacked by the Babylonians. Then much later on, God would send someone even better than the prophet. He would send his own son. But once again, rather than choosing to listen to God through his own son, they chose to reject him, and they crucified him. And what did God allow to happen then? 70 AD, Jerusalem was destroyed. The temple, no stone left standing on one another, and the Israelites were scattered throughout the world. And so today I want us to consider these choices Joshua made, the choices the people made, and think about our own choices and what they say. For see, folks, one thing that our choices teach us or really say about us, our choices say a lot about our priorities in our lives. All of Joshua's life, he chose to trust and obey the Lord because God was his priority. And why was God was his priority? He had experienced the goodness of God. And he chose to trust God. And folks, that's why he made it his priority. And we have to realize our choices reflect our priorities. For Jesus said, where your treasure is, there your heart and thoughts will be also. Let's take, for example, suppose you say that your family is your priority, but you choose to spend time with everybody else or doing all us other sorts of things rather than spending time with your family. The choice to do those other things shows what your real priority is. Or how about this, church? I talked to the kids a little bit, and now I'm kind of preaching to the choir because y'all the ones that are here today, all of you out here. But you know, it occurred to me that we're telling God we're making a choice about our priorities when we come to worship. Do we come to worship Him all the time or just when it's convenient? You see, the church has bought in. By the way, this is just water. How many times have Bridget and I have talked about this and other preachers? Oh, well, it's football season. It's race weekend. It's too hot. It's too cold. It's a holiday. People have things to do. We preachers have learned to make excuses for all of us. But what are we saying when we choose regularly to do something else than to come to worship the living God? What is that saying about our priorities? And folks, if a church says, for example, we want to bring new people to Jesus Christ, but the main thing we focus on is taking care of who we already have, what does that choice say about our priorities? Folks, every day, the choices you make say a lot about your priorities, but they also say a lot about your commitments. Joshua told the people, choose today who you're going to be committed to, the false gods of this world or the true God of the universe. Now, when you get thinking about the word commitment, commitment's almost a dirty word in our society today. Because people don't want to be committed to anything that might limit what they want to do. I can't serve here, I can't do this, because it might mean it will affect when I want to go do so and so. Well, you know, it occurred to me as I was listening that something is happening in America about that shows where we're headed concerning commitments. It's a new thing that I believe with all my heart is from the pit of Hades himself. It's called an open marriage. Have you heard about it? It's what's happening in many marriages across the country. Oh, they want to be committed to each other on a certain level, but they still want to have physical relationships with other people when they want to. What's the point of even getting married? Or how about, well, let's just live together and not get married. That way, if we decide it's not working out, it's just easy to get out of. We don't want commitment. And folks, a lot of people today, a lot of Christians, they want to sign on to this eternal life thing. They want that, but they don't want to sign on to the commitment that they're supposed to allow the Holy Spirit to move them toward being like Jesus, no longer living like the world. And I heard a Vonnie clip that kind of expresses this. I watched it this week, and it was a black preacher, and he was preaching a powerful sermon. And he said, you know, I got a lady in my church, and she'll praise God and hallelujah and all this good stuff. But one day I picked up the phone and I called her, and she didn't recognize the phone number. And she got really mad because she thought it was a sales call. And she said, who is this? What are you? How'd you get my number, you blankety blank? And he said, well, hello, sister so-and-so. This is brother so-and-so. She said, well, praise God. Hallelujah. Right? Folks, that's not just in the black church. It's in the white church. It's in the red church. A lot of times we want to play. But you see, following Jesus calls for true and total commitment. We can't be in a situation where we try to say we love the Lord while we still worship our golden calves. Can I get an amen? And every year, about this time, y'all know one of the golden calves I'm going to bring up. What is it, church? Football. Hunting season. Fishing season. We got to be careful. For Jesus said, you cannot serve two masters, for you will hate one and love the other, or to be devoted to one and despise the other. Also, folks, did you know our choices even say something about our relationships? What was the very first commandment? No, it was not, thou shalt not wear an Auburn jersey to an Alabama football game. That's not the first commandment, folks. The first commandment says, there shall be no other gods than me. Now, I kind of wonder that. Why did God tell us that? I mean, is there really any other gods? I don't know about y'all, but I believe in a monotheistic God, the God of the heaven and earth that created everything. I don't believe in a bunch of other spiritual beings. There's true God. Yet, in America, even we have other gods. Even if we believe in the one true God, don't we? We can have that golden calf. And that can even, and so God's telling us, you got to put me first. But he also said in Deuteronomy 6, and Jesus echoed it in Matthew 22, he says, you must love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength. Why? Why did God tell us this is a commandment? Because God is perfect love, and perfect love demands an expression. And so he wants us to love him back. And you may say, well, okay, but you say he gives us a free will choice of whether we love him back. Why do you make it a commitment? I'll tell you why, I mean a commandment. Why do you think God says love me first? Because God knows what it does to you when you love other things first. There is no human being, nothing this world can offer, including other human beings, that will bring you peace, joy, and have the faithfulness that the one true God will have. Come on, church, are y'all awake? Other things will disappoint us. Folks, so just understand what our choices say a lot about our relationships. Like if I say I love somebody, but I treat them badly all the time, and I don't spend time with them, what does that really say about my relationship with that person? Some say that we have a relationship with God, but they hardly ever talk to God. Folks, if our choice is to spend God with God, it ought to be the first thing we think about. Not Facebook, not the internet, not Fox News, not CNN News. It'll be the first thing we think about in the morning. And folks, I'm preaching to myself now, because I'm guilty about it too. So folks, I want you to think about this question. Does God know by the choices you make every day that you love Him? And finally, the correct choice will always lead to a blessing. God said to Joshua, "Be strong and courageous. If you obey me, I will make your way prosperous and you will have great success." And I think it's interesting that, as I said earlier, he and Caleb, the only two that made it in there, because they did trust God, while the other 10 didn't. But folk, and God would lead Joshua, and Joshua, would make the right choice to trust and obey God with those unusual things that I told you about. Crossing the river, the wall around Jordan. But then comes a biggie. In chapter 11 of Joshua, we hear that many, many kings from the area decide they are going to go against Joshua and the Israelites. In chapter 11, it says, "So they combined their armies, along with a vast array of horses and chariots." And listen to this, it said, "They covered the landscape like the sand of the seashore. They established their camp around the water near Mermon to fight against the Israelites." So many fire chariots, all that stuff, that it looked like sands of the seashore. It seemed impossible that Joshua could defeat them. But then God says to Joshua, "Do not be afraid of them, for tomorrow at this time I will hand them over to you." So Joshua and his troops could have chosen to say, we're not going this time. That's just too much. We're turning around. We're going back to Egypt. But that's not what they did. They chose to trust in the Lord their God. And so chapter 11 ends this way. "So Joshua took control of the land, just as the Lord had instructed Moses. He gave the people of Israel as their special possession, dividing the land among the tribes. So the land was finally had rest from wars." Folks, that tells us that they trusted in God and God gave them success. This reminds us that we have a choice to make, even in times when days look bleak and dreary and we may be going through suffering or doubt or discouragement, because we have to remember, if we trust in the Lord our God, David said, "Weeping may go on all night, but joy comes in the morning." And when we choose to trust God through what He has promised through Jesus Christ, we will be blessed in this life. I don't mean it'll all go easy, but I mean you'll have an inner strength that, even though you may ebb and flow at times, you'll have an inner strength to get through it all. But you will also have the greatest blessing of all time when you get to be with the Lord Jesus forever. So we have a choice every day when we're tempted to give in to the world. To hang on or to tuck tail and run. But Jesus said, in the end, sin will be rampant everywhere and the love of many will go cold. And they will choose to leave. But those that choose to endure to the end will be saved. Now, I don't want to wrap this sermon up in a negative way, but you'll notice that it says the correct choice will always lead to a blessing. But, now, last week, if any of y'all came to the thing about Israel, he taught us that there's a word in Hebrew for "but" with a twist. I mean, okay, this is true, but you need to be aware of this. Folks, what I didn't share with you when we read the scripture earlier that Jennifer read is that after the people said, "We choose the Lord," then Joshua went on to say this in chapter 24, verse 20. "If you forsake the Lord and serve foreign gods, then he will turn and do you harm and consume you after he's done you good." We don't like to hear that. We don't like to hear that if we choose just to kind of turn away from God, that we might be losing a close walk with God. We don't like to hear that God might allow some things to happen to get our attention. But clearly that's what he did to the Israelites, and he will do it to us. He will allow some things in our life sometimes to make us realize you've made a bad choice. But folks, if you don't listen to him, it can have eternal consequences. We can choose to trust in God's plan of salvation and be eternally blessed with God, or we can refuse to trust in Christ and suffer eternal consequences. Because one thing that's kind of bothered me this week, folks, my dad's reading this book and he shared something with me, and I think it kind of bothered him. And I had to remind him, like I did my mother, if you believe in Jesus and you're living for Jesus, you're okay. But Jesus also said there's going to be a lot of people that think they're going to go to heaven, and they're going to say, "Well, Lord, I did this in your name and I did that in your name." And Jesus is going to say, "Get behind me. I never knew you." So who are those people that Jesus would say that to? The people who have chose to fake it. Folks, if you want to make it to heaven, you sure can't fake it here on earth. So the choice we have is to trust in the Lord our God, to obey his word, and live according to his will. And if we do that, then we can be assured we'll be with him. But folks, God gives you a free will, and the choice is yours. Let us pray. Father God, I just ask this morning that you will move in our congregation. Father, if there's someone here today that has never really made the choice to accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, that today would be the day. But Lord, if there's someone here today that maybe they feel like something said that your Holy Spirit's kind of tugging on them to make them realize it's time to make a choice to get serious about our relationship with you. Many times, oh Lord, we choose just to kind of take it for granted. But Father, if it's your will, I just pray that your Holy Spirit would tug on hearts. If they need to come to the altar and to pray about this, or if they just need to stay in their seat, whatever. But Father, I pray that they will hear this is serious. And the choices we make about you have eternal rewards, but also can turn out the eternal consequences. In Jesus Christ's holy name we pray. Amen. The Lord has spoken to you in the sermon today or through the music, and you have something that the Lord's tugging on your heart about. The altar's open if you want to come to pray. I can pray with you. Otherwise, feel free to stay in your seat if the Holy Spirit's leaving. But you make a choice if the Holy Spirit's working on you on whether you stay or obey. Let's sing together.
Hymn number 700, "Abide with Me." Please stand.
Me.
And now may the love of God, the grace and peace of the Lord Jesus Christ, and the presence of the Holy Spirit be with you now and always. Amen.